Well, hello to our online church family. I'm Pastor Ben, and it's such a joy to have you with us today. Hey, we're going to get straight into the Word, so I encourage you to lean in, to pop down your coffee, open up your phone, your device, your notepad. Let's take down notes, and let's grow in God together.
As today is the halfway party, part two, we're going to hear from some of our team sharing on kind of what they've been up to this year and some of the highlights. But first, before I get all of those up, we're going to hear from some kids, along with our kids leader, Mute. They're going to come and share kind of what have been their highlights, what have they been up to in the kids program. So can we please give a big welcome? Awesome. Come on up. I might need mic as well. That'd be awesome. So good. Over to you, Mute.
Sweet. Got to check. Oh, good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. Just like what Pastor Ben said, my name's Mute. Lorraine's out there with the looking after the kids this year and also last year as well. We just jumped on the ministry. And yeah, I picked the highlight for both myself and Lorraine has been, I think we've had 12 or 15 decisions made for Christ within the kids' church. So that's just been in the last 6 months. I think Easter we had 8 or 9. So yeah, we're actually enjoying it there in the kids. So parents, please don't stress that your kids are well looked after. We're investing really well into the kids with the Word and the resources that we do have. So so Pastor Ben asked myself and Lorraine if there was anything that we wanted to share. So that was on behalf of myself, Lorraine, and the kids team. But then I thought, what better way to hear stories from the four walls, from the kids' church, to just hear it from the kids' voices themselves. So I asked these guys just this morning. So I've really just put them on the spot. No, I didn't bribe them. No, yeah, I did. I told them I'll give them candy next week. So I told them if they're, yeah. So we got the beautiful girls here from the class down in CK3. So I look after the 8 to 11. So yeah, hand it over to the girls and they'll quickly share on what they've been learning this year within the kids' church. Thank you.
I used to think reading the Bible and learning stories from it was really boring, but when I went to kids' church, they put it into a fun way so we can learn more about it. And one of the things I learned that you can heal people by believing and praying.
I learned that God forgives us and believes in us, that when we're stuck in hard things and when we do bad things, he still loves us and forgives us. And at Kids Church, our team leaders help us make it fun for our learning.
So that's from Lisha, Lizzo, Don't Worry, Jazz, and Ari was just here to support their friends. So yeah, God bless everybody and enjoy the service. Thank you. Awesome. Give him a big hand.
It is such a great job. Last week, that downstairs room that Mute runs was packed, so you ended up going to the cafe area, hey? So, which was cool. So we're looking at, over the next couple of months, launching another program for intermediate. So I've just said he's got to build a team for that first so we can do that. So if you're interested in that to help be part of it, launch another room for intermediate age group kids, see Mute and Lorraine. There she is, Lorraine. Hello. Awesome. What a great job you guys do. So that'll be awesome. Well, I'm going to invite up some of our team coaches. So come on, Kyle, Lonnie, Zara, Tim, Shamla, and Vanessa. Come and join me. Brilliant. Well, hello. Hello, everybody. We got a couple of extra mics. Awesome. So good. So we're going to be sharing a bit of the highlights, but to kind of do a bit of a walk down memory lane, I just want to remind everyone some of the things that have happened this year. So we launched with a series on eternal legacy, on leaving a legacy that lasts into eternity, which was great. We talked about reaching people for Jesus, using what we have to make a kingdom difference. We did a revival month here, which was an incredible month. We talked about revival in my life, revival in my family, revival in our church, and revival in our city. And that was just an incredible month. There was such a hunger in this place for God. We also later got Pastor Wayne in, and the prophetic was flowing over heaps of people. And so it was an awesome time. Then we had a soul night with Pastor Mike Mulheron over here, which was awesome. We launched the playground. We baptized people in February, which was awesome. We had summer awakening camp, amplified for the youth. We launched a youth band, so that's just recently launched, which is exciting, a youth band that runs on Friday. We had Love Week. We had 58 decisions for Christ, which is awesome. We can celebrate that, give God some praise for that. And now we're in the Rule and Reign series. That's some of the things. And so I'd love to hear from you guys now. So we've got Lonnie over here, who along with his wife runs our worship team. So if you kind of think over the last 6 months, what's kind of, give us a bit of an update about the creative team and what's sort of been the highlight for you.
Yeah, hey guys, my name is Lonnie, as Pastor Ben mentioned. So we've been overseeing the creative team for the last 2 years, last year, since last year. But I think the biggest thing for me is, for us, is just, I just want to quickly honor our creative team. Everyone that serves in the creative team, the time that they invest, the effort, the Wednesday nights, the 2 hours before service to be here. And, you know, it's not just to sound pretty or to sound good, but it's to create the space where people can come in and just be free and encounter God. And that's what I guess I love, seeing our team just and all the talents, all the different personalities come together and put this sound together called worship. You know, that's worship and just creating the space where people can just come and encounter God. And so for me, the highlight is my team, as the people that serve week in, week out. They serve in multiple areas. I remember one time there was Brett, Kyle, and Alfie at the back at the sound desk. But when I look back there, it was a picture of generations of people that invested into one another. You know, Kyle wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for Brett. Alfie wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for Kyle investing into him. And so, you know, that's what I love. I love seeing that. I love seeing people growing in their gifts, you know, just being creative, feeling, you know, free to be creative and worship and express God through their creative gifts. And just a highlight, sorry, the win for us as a team, seeing new people come. There's new people come here. And, you know, they're already just, man, already grooving, just worshiping, lifting their hands, you know, and just complete freedom, just in awe of who God is because of what we've created as a team. Before everyone's come here, we've already set the atmosphere. And so that's what I love. That's a highlight for us. It's just, man, this morning when we were singing the Regardless song, The Bridge, you know, just the voices, hearing people respond in faith, you are the hope, with no instruments in the background, but just, you know, responding in faith, you know, singing the song and making just that declaration, you are the hope that never will run dry. And so for us as a team, that's our win. That's why we do it, is to see people encounter God. Yeah.
Awesome. What an amazing job you guys do. And I love your heart that you're raising up an army of worshipers that will just seek God's face and worship him above everything else. And so just an incredible job you and Rachel do. And Kyle runs the production, the tech team,
yep.
Which is awesome. So we'd love to hear from you now on kind of what's been happening in the production team and what are your kind of highlights?
Yeah. So hi, guys. Kyle, I run the production team at the back there, all the electronics and gadgets and magical wizardry that goes on at the back. I'm just so grateful that I have the ability to use the gifts that God has given me to, that He's given me just to serve and worship. I first like to, for this past 6 months, I first like to give it up for my team, all the hard work that they've done behind the scenes.
Yeah.
That no one sees, you know, the stressful times, the happy times. They're running around at the back, not knowing if the church is going to burn down. A lot of people see the end product, but there's a lot of sort of under the water. You just see, all these things going on in the back that, a lot of buttons being pushed and decisions being made just to create one seamless service.
Or what about the 9:30 Saturday night call from me going, we're in lockdown tomorrow. Get your tech guys. It's on.
just doing all these things and just give it up for these guys that put in a lot of hard work and behind the scenes. Specifically two people that come to mind are Alfie and Zara. These two. Alfie just completed his internship with City Point. A lot of hard work gone on from that guy and change in character and heart for serving. I just like to give it up for him. And Zara. And so Zara, to my right, she's incredible. She is, we just started, I think it's been a couple of months now, but we started our online service at 7:30. I know a lot of you guys get the notification on your social media. Zara is the one behind the scenes sitting here late at night by herself, doing all the background work and running that service. So just like to give it up for her as well. Awesome. The few wins that I've got, we've seen through that online service, we've seen a lot of people come to church, a lot of people engaged, and that's our overall target, for having a camera at the back and having all that equipment. That has been provided by us by your generosity, by the church's generosity, by Faith, Love, Hope, and by the donations of a lot of people in this church and even outside this church. We've got so much gear and we're so blessed. And it's such a timely thing that when we got locked into lockdown, everybody wanted to get all the churches wanted to get cameras and streaming equipment. And we've got donated so much equipment at that time. I don't know how. It's only by God's grace that, equipment came just like that. The donations just came in and it was incredible. This past 6 months has really been a challenge, but really blessing just to see people come to church via our efforts and via, online streaming.
So good. So good. And what a great job you guys. So let's give them a big hand. Awesome. Well, I think it's time to hear from the youth and what's been happening there and what are some of the wins. So Zara, do you want to go first, and then
I feel like Tim's one leads off better to mine.
All right, Tim, go for it.
Okay, my name's Tim. Alongside Zara, we both run the youth, and I think just want to, like Lonnie and Kyle as well, I just want to give it up for my team as well, because they do things. If you're in leadership, you can't do everything. They do things that I can't do. So I'm usually the guy in front, connecting with everyone and just having fun and playing around and doing that. And Zara, I always tell everyone that Zara always makes me look good because she's doing everything in the background. Also, just the rest of my team as well, Alfie, as well as Lotto, Georgia, Michelle, Jared, and Elijah as well. Just give it Eddie. Up for them. And Eddie as well, he's running the youth band. So they're awesome. Without them, we wouldn't have our Friday nights as well. So, but I think I got a few highlights, like Pastor Ben was saying as well, and them was, at the start of the year, we were trying to figure out what's going to happen with camp, because obviously COVID and everything last year took place, and we were trying to figure out whether we're going to have camp or not, but we ended up just doing it anyway, and to see the amount of kids that did come and were interested in coming, and just being able to touch their lives as well and see God work through them was amazing. But also Amplified happened last month. But it was, we managed to see this room packed out. Just saw so many, youth in this room who love God and come to worship God as well. But we did see decisions as well. We saw about, I think, 90. There was about almost 100 people there.
Yeah.
And then 9 decisions as well. So that was amazing. But I think for me as well, like a big highlight has been being able to build relationships with the youth to the point where it's gotten to where they can message us throughout the week as well and just call us and, you know, ask for things. You know, if they're going through something, we can be there as well for them too.
Yeah.
You know, just to guide them and just to help them, encourage them in what they're going through. So I think that's been a big thing for me is being able to build relationships with the youth and mainly the youth boys as well for our youth boys life group. So, yeah that's been a big highlight this year and it's been awesome. Still going and we're going to keep going hard. So,
great. Yeah. So good. Thanks, Tim. So good. Zara, and then we're going to hear from Vanessa about prayer.
Kind of leading off of what Tim said about our relationships, it's a really big thing, I guess, for us is like, obviously relationships are really big, but to be able to invest in our youth, we really have to have the relationship. And I think that really has been a big thing in my girls' life group, specifically in the girls that are in it. They've been really up to hearing me speak into their lives, up to being able to have God speak through them. 2 weeks ago, we were actually at youth and we split into boys and girls. And originally, we were just supposed to be praying over each other to be like, we want to pray over your big dreams. We want you guys to pursue your dreams. We're going to believe with you. It turned into probably almost an hour-long session where we all prayed over each girl and kind of like a hot seat. And pretty much every girl in the chat, in the group, had a prophetic word for another person, shared got what God had for them. Some of the girls had pictures, had words, had... Wow. Had scriptures just to encourage each other. Amazing. And it was just amazing to see that God, they're willing to have God move through them and willing to hear him and speak out even though they're not sure if it was him. And then on Friday, we had a combined youth night with The River and CACC. So we all met up and had a whole lot of games and worship and everything. And while we were there, we had some ministry time and one of the youth girls came up to me and was like, hey, I feel like I need to pray for someone. So I was just like, sure, let's go. Do you know who it is? At that point, she didn't. But then in the end of it, she figured it out who God was telling her to pray for. She went and prayed for this person. And this was from a different church. And then after the service, she talked to the youth pastor because the youth pastor wanted to talk to her. She finds out what she prayed for was exactly what that person needed.
Wow.
She finds out that God really spoke through her to this person.
Wow.
And just seeing our youth being able to, like, actually listen to God and hear him speak and let him speak through them is just so encouraging to see, like, it sounds weird, bad saying, but they've been listening to us and willing to actually have God move through them because they've been actually taking in what we've been teaching. But, yeah, that's my highlight.
Oh, awesome. So good. Incredible. What a great job you and Tim and all the team do in the youth. So incredible. So, Vanessa, tell us about prayer and what's happening with your team and what's coming. That'd be great.
Hi, my name is Vanessa and I lead the prayer team here at City Point. What that involves is we have a team of people that pray and when people fill out prayer cards or if they send prayer requests online, I email that out to the team, whether it be weekly or however often those come in, and we pray for those prayer requests. And that's how it's been working for the last couple of years. But this year, I've been chatting to Pastor Ben, and we've just felt that there's more to prayer than just praying for people's individual needs. And while all that is good, our aim is to get more involved in the corporate side of prayer and to pray for our church and to pray for the vision of the church and even to pray for our city. In the past, we haven't really gathered together as a team, but this year we've had one gathering where we all, some of us that were able to come, we had a lunch together with Pastor Ben and Pastor Mike Mulheron from Brisbane, and Pastor Ben just shared what his heart was for our team, and he highlighted some of the things that he'd like us to concentrate our prayers on. What we will also be doing next week, in fact, is we're going to start gathering together as a team in the mornings before the morning service. And it's just going to be a short time of prayer, about 15 minutes. It's going to be starting at 9:30. And we're going to be concentrating on praying for our church and all those corporate needs of our church and our city. And we'd also like to open up that to anyone who wants to join us for that session. You know, whether you've just joined the church and you want to know what's involved in prayer, or whether you've been praying for years and years and years for the church, Please feel free to join us. At this stage, it'll be at 9:30, just after the team prayer, and we'll be having it in the small kitchen that's on the side. That is our highlight.
Awesome. And is that kicking off next week?
Yeah, next week.
Cool. Next week, Sunday, the 18th. Awesome. Brilliant. Let's give it up for Vanessa and the prayer team. So good. I want to really honour and thank you and the team for all the unseen prayers. God's seen them. Prayers that you've prayed, and probably for most of the people in this room at some point you've been on the prayer list, and these guys have been crying out to God on your behalf, and so what an amazing job they do. So thank you. We want to honour you for that. So awesome. Well, Shamla, who runs our cafe team, tell us how it's all going. What's happening? What's your highlights?
I want to thank my fabulous team that works effortlessly into the cafe week after week. And I know I do text you a lot. So therefore, I'm going to be recruiting new people for the cafe.
Right.
Okay. But the highlights for the past 6 months, I think it's really an awesome time to come around coffee and food, chatting, getting to know each other, getting to know your names. It's been really great, and getting positive comments about the food, that's important, but mainly the fellowship with new people and old people coming together around Kai is the best time. You know that. When you go visiting, you always have to have Kai, right? Food is to everyone's heart.
Bring people together. Yeah,
and,
come on.
And I love the way we all come back and we all come to the table. We all come to the cafe. New people come to the cafe for a cup of coffee. And that's great when you bring your friends along and say, oh, my friend is here for the first time. Can we give them a cup of coffee? And that's great. And that's how we get to meet people. And I know we may not be out there with you guys that are fellowshipping all the time, but we are fellowshipping from this end of it.
Great.
And cafe team is important. The girls, they do an awesome job at the cafe. One team member said to me this morning, I feel I'm a new member in church, and my way of giving back to the church is her way of kindness or serving others is serving behind the cafe,
awesome.
You know, and that's great.
So
also another member said to me, we have lows in the week, but serving really picks you up. I don't know, for me personally, I find that an enormous task. Because sometimes you are way down during the week and we come to church on a Sunday morning and we have to serve. And you know, this is not a paid job, but it's paid in acts of random kindness.
Great.
And our smile. It's so important when we come in the morning, if you come into the cafe and if somebody is really grumpy there, it's not going to make your day. But you know, all of us come with different needs and all of our faces differ. But if you see a smiley face, and smiles are for free.
Yeah.
So, you know, we need that. All of us need that. Whether I'm at the cafe or you are there, we all need that. So having a smile is really important. Coming around coffee is really important. And we haven't poisoned anybody yet. So,
there's not going to be a yet, right? We'll just have
a good way to learn people's names. And good way to communicate around the cafe. I know we get busy sometimes and you don't get served the way you want to be served. But patience with us. We are working on it, right? And I want to thank the church also for the Love Hope offering that we've also started doing stuff in the kitchen. We have a bench top now to work with. And getting there slowly but surely. And I want to thank the team that comes early too, and for the prayer team. And as you said, you know, there's not one person in the team. And remember, when you spell team, there's no I in team. So I may be sitting here, but the team is running the cafe. So I'm not the only one that's in the team. So all of us work as a team. So I could not do it by myself. It's all these guys and you guys that come in that makes the team. And I want to encourage whoever wants to join the team to please come and see me. I'm just recruiting.
I was going to get you to plug, so go on. Give it a plug.
Yes.
Still need baristas, hey?
Yes.
We need everybody.
We need everybody.
Cooks, baristas.
As I said to you before, if you want to be put to use, come and see me and I can put you to use anywhere, okay? But thank you guys. And I tell you, it's been really great serving. We had different functions, as you guys have mentioned, and we've been trying to serve different food. We're thinking of other stuff. So if you got comments and you got some ideas, we're looking for it.
Sure.
So come and see us or take a post-it note and write it down if you don't want to be named. That's fine. So we want to take all ideas into consideration. I don't know, pizzas. Today is party day. So party food is pizza food, right? So come and see the cafe today. We got party food today.
Awesome.
Donuts and pizza.
Awesome.
So we want to try for different occasions, could do different foods and international food. We want to go around everyone's culture.
Yeah.
And we want you guys to help us. So please come and meet the cafe team. And we love serving you guys.
Right. Awesome. Give them a big hand. What a great job the cafe team does. And there's also host team at Cherry is away today. But the host team is the welcome team here at City Point Church. And they're the ones that are welcoming you at the front door with a big smile, setting the atmosphere. And probably if I think of the win, I'm forever getting comments from people about the love that they feel when they walk into this place. They felt loved, they felt accepted, they felt cared for. And so the host team just does such a phenomenal job of that love. Probably the other win with the host team that I'm seeing is we're just getting so good at noticing people. That people are not, you know, standing around by themselves for a long time. We're just getting good, and not just as a host team, but as a church, at noticing people, at stopping. And the bigger we are, the more challenging it is. It takes everyone to, whenever you walk into a room, to stop and look for who can you show love to. But they just do such an amazing job. The host team set up this place on a Sunday morning. They welcome people into this place. They really set the atmosphere, show that love so that people can walk in and their hearts are open and ready to hear the word. And one person that heard the word and responded last week was Keith, who's just up the back there next to Kerry. Last week, Keith gave his heart to the Lord, which was just incredible, which is phenomenal. And Keith is getting accommodation sorted, so he might be moving somewhere. And at some point, we've got to baptize you, bro. So we've got to figure that out. And I want to pray with you to receive the Holy Spirit too. But I was just sharing the gospel with him just yesterday about how Jesus died on the cross for him as a plan for his life. And his eyes just opened and he just got it. He just understood God's love for him, that no matter what he's done, Christ has died on the cross for the forgiveness of his sins, you know, that he'd be forgiven, he can be free and start a relationship with God. And there was just such joy in you, wasn't there? It was just like, whoa, this is awesome. He's pumped. It's people's stories above it all. And that's what these guys are representing and sharing, and ultimately represents people's stories. And that's the greatest joy, is when someone's life is transformed, is touched by God, they make a decision to follow Jesus. It's just the greatest joy. And so we're excited for your journey, Keith. But those are some of the highlights that you've heard this morning from these guys. So can we give them a big hand and just honor them and thank them? So good. So good. Well, we're going to get straight into the Word of God. I am going to bring this message into 20 minutes of power. In Jesus' name, touch somebody and say, get ready to hear the word. Awesome. Well, we started a new series called Rule and Reign, that you're called to rule and reign in this life to be victorious. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so last week I spoke about being a party starter. When Keith made that decision for Christ, there was a party in heaven. And we're called to be people that are party starters, that share the gospel with others, that they might receive Christ and there'll be a party in heaven. Let's be people that are party starters. Amen? But as we talk about this series on rule and reign, I want to talk about knowing who we are in God. And I want to speak a passage in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 to 19. I'm going to get straight into it. And it says this: when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" Who do men say? They said, you know, some say John the Baptist, which is silly that some said that, because John the Baptist and Jesus were around at the same time next to each other. Anyway, some say Elijah, And others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets coming back to life. This is what people are saying. And Jesus says, who do you say I am? Because that's important. Not just what other people say, but what do you say? What's your revelation of God? Who do you say that Jesus is? Who do you say? Who is God to you? Who do you say that he is? And it's such an important question that we're able to answer, who is Jesus? In fact, the most important questions in this life is who is God? Who am I? And what am I here for? What's my purpose? Who is God? Who am I? And what am I here for? And if we're going to rule and reign in this life, we better know the answers to those questions. Who is God? Who am I? So here Jesus asks his disciples and Simon Peter answers and he says, you are the Christ. You're the anointed one. You're the Messiah, the one that the prophecies talked about, that one would be sent from heaven. It's you. You're the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said, blessed are you, happy are you, to be envied, fortunate are you, Simon bar Jonah, meaning Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And now Jesus tells him who he is. He said, I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I'll give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. God, I just pray for this message. I pray and I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're present with us. Let it not just be another message, Lord, that we walk out the same. I pray you'd meet every person right now, wherever they're at. I pray, Holy Spirit, you would encourage them. You'd bring life and bring change to all of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So here Peter gets a revelation of who God is. It's so important that we know that question because how we see God determines how we respond to him. How we see God. If you think God's the angry God, the distant God, maybe you're not going to pursue a loving relationship with him. But if you see God as the Almighty, the Alpha and the Omega, a loving Father that is personal and wants to know, you know, God wants a personal relationship with you, not a distant, but a personal relationship with you. As you get a revelation of who God is, then we can start to learn who we are. To discover yourself, it's not about looking deeper within, but it's about looking further above because God created you. If you want to know what's the meaning behind the abstract art, I'm no artist, I promise you that. But if you want to know the meaning behind this abstract art painting that somebody does, well, you better ask the artist. Because he painted that picture. If you want to know what's the meaning behind it, what it's about, what's its purpose, what was it, what were you articulating, we better ask the artist. Well, God is the artist that designed us, that created us. So if we want to know who we are, we better come back and ask our creator. Amen? So in this story, now that Peter gets a revelation of who God is, Jesus turns and tells him who he is. You see, Simon was the name that his father gave him. Now, Simon, as I looked into the different scholarly thoughts and what's the original meaning for Simon, the most common is one who listens, one who hears, one who listens. But some translations say that a variable that Simon comes from Simeon, so that's the one who listens. And then some say it means reed, like a reed tossed to and fro, a reed, like a water reed. And another one says it can also be from a Greek adjective meaning flat-nosed. Flat-nosed one. Any flat-nosed ones here in this place? Flat-nosed one. So here we have Simon, the one who hears is derived from the Hebrew word. The Holman Bible Dictionary says it's flat-nosed is the Greek adjective, and other scholars such as David Pawson says a water reed. So Simon, a flat-nosed listener, as skinny as a reed, who's the son of Jonah, which is a peaceful dove. So you are Simon. That's what he was called. But Jesus wanted to give him another name. See, names carried power. They carried power. It wasn't just, you know, hey, Bob, or hey, John, or hey. That had a meaning because it was actually their language. So every time they said Jonah, they were saying peaceful dove. Peaceful as a dove. That's what they were saying every time they called him. So every time they're saying Simon, you know, listener or read or flat nose. Hey, flat nose. Hey, flat nose. Come, flat nose. I've got to talk to you. Hey, flat nose. Come over here. That's what it said. So Jesus says, I want to, blessed are you. And then he says, you are Peter. This is who you are. And as I look through the Bible, and it says in Matthew that Peter was the name that Jesus gave Simon. So Jesus gives him a new name. Isn't that incredible? And I believe that God wants to give us a new name. Because we get names too that we attach ourselves to. I'm this, I'm that, I'm not good enough. This is just who I am. This is how I'm always going to be. And we get labels and names and things that we attach ourselves to. Simon was the name that came from his father, Simon, son of Jonah. And in the same way, names that we have can come from early experiences in our life. Things that happen in our family, things that happen in our school, tragedy that happened in our life, disappointment, rejection, mistreatment, hurtful words said about us, betrayal, mistrust, embarrassment, shame, guilt, and the list goes on. But here Jesus comes and says, you are Peter, which means you're a rock. And then he says, and on this rock, now the first rock for Peter means a small rock, one that can be like a stone that you can pick up. It's from the Greek word Petros. You are Petros. You're a small rock. And on this rock, Petra, meaning a huge rock, I will build my church. So Peter isn't the foundation that Jesus builds his church on. Peter is the rock, the small rock, and Jesus says, I will build my church on this large rock. What is he talking about? On the revelation of Jesus, on Peter understanding who Jesus is. That's going to be the foundation of the church. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the foundation of the church. Jesus as the chief cornerstone, Paul writes. Amen? So Jesus is the foundation of the church, and he says, Peter, you are a rock. You are Peter. You are a rock. So Peter gets a new identity. He gets a new name. He's not a reed that's just tossed to and fro. He's not just the flat-nosed one or just one that only hears or listens. He's a rock. There's strength in you, Peter. You're dependable. You're strong. You can do it. Jesus is speaking into his destiny. Isn't that incredible? You know, it's interesting that when I think of Peter, it's like, hold on, Jesus, this is the guy that denied you three times. You're really saying he's a rock? Oh, wasn't very rocky then, was he? Hey? You're calling him Rocky. He's the guy that bailed out when a girl said, do you know Jesus? No, I don't know him. And you're saying he's a rock? Like, seriously? This is the guy that you rebuked and said, get behind me, Satan. This is the guy that in the Garden of Gethsemane, when they were coming to arrest Jesus, he pulls out a sword and chops the guy's ear off. Blop, 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 blop. That's that guy. And you're saying he's a rock? Maybe this is because God sees who you are beyond your failures. Because God sees the real you beyond your failures. Amen? He loves you so much, he sees the real you. And Peter's identity comes from the words of Jesus. Who he is comes from God. And in the same way, who you really are is not necessarily who you think you are or who others think you are or say you are. We've got to come back to, what does God say about me? I've got to come back to the artist who created me, who crafted my life. Before I was even in the mother's womb, he set me apart and called me. That's how I discover who you are. And you know, the devil wants you to live defeated, thinking that you're less than, not enough, not capable. If he can get you to do that, you'll start to believe it. And you'll start to live your life that way, never fully reaching the potential you have inside. Not able to do anything great for God because you don't try, you live defeated. I know a young guy who's one of the best junior rugby players in Auckland, one of the absolute best players. He could 100% be a professional rugby player. He's not even playing rugby right now because he doesn't believe in himself. The self-doubt that he has is robbing this young person of his destiny and future. And in the same way, if we don't start to get an understanding of who we are in God. That in Christ we are enough. In Christ we can overcome. In Christ we're victorious. If we don't start to understand this, you're always going to miss the mark. You'll live defeated. You won't take hold of the promise and the plan that God has for your life. How you see yourself affects every area of your life. It affects the job you apply for. It affects how you act in relationships. It affects you as a parent. It affects the courage you have or lack of. It affects the business you run, the job you do, the confidence you have in challenging situations, and the impact you make for God. The good news is you can change how you think about yourself. That's the great news. Romans 12 verse 2 says, don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We're changed by the renewing of our mind, it says. How do we do that? It's the word of God. This is how we do it. Peter's identity came from the word of God, the words of Jesus. You're blessed. You are Peter. You are a rock. This is who you are. And when we start to declare this over our life, we start to believe it. I was chatting with a friend of mine who's a counselor, and he was saying that what happens is as people keep saying these negative things over their life, they develop like these pathways in their brain. And every time you say it, it's like another layer on that pathway. It gets stronger. It gets stronger. I'm no good. I'm no good. I'm not. You keep saying it. It gets stronger and stronger until it becomes so strong you really start to believe it and you take that on. But then he said what he does is get people to start declaring positive things about their life and they start to build new pathways in their brain. And eventually they keep saying it and saying it and saying, and it gets stronger. And now this becomes part of what they believe. Amazing. If you think about it but in our context, declaring what God says over our life, declaring the word of God over our life. And then these pathways and networks get stronger and we stop believing those lies of the enemy, stop believing those negative and hurtful things, and we start believing the word of God. It's powerful. So what he does in the counseling room, and this is probably commonly known as like cognitive behavior therapy, he gets people to start declaring, it's fighting those thoughts, and he gets them to say three positive things every day for a month. He says at the end of the month, it's transformational. It's so different how people see themselves because they're strengthening these thoughts and beliefs of who they are. You can change the way that you think. It's quite amazing. And that's what the Bible says. We're transformed by the renewing of your mind. And it's not just because I renewed my mind yesterday means I'm all good for today. Oh, I did that a year ago, Pastor Ben. We've got to do it daily. We've got to constantly renew our mind because our mind can go negative. The flesh, the sinful nature in us wants to pull us away from the ways of God. And we've got to declare what God says and renew our mind. And the word of God is our weapon against the enemy. Every time Jesus was tempted by the devil, he said, no, devil, it is written. Man shall not live by bread alone. Every time he said, it is written, it is written. You can go read it in Matthew chapter 4. Many of us will know the story. It's the word of God is our weapon. It's the sword of the Spirit, the Bible says. It's the sword of the Spirit. It's a weapon. John 8, 32. You'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. The word of God, we renew it by the word of God. So here is how to do it. Let me just get my weapon, get my word on. If I can call up my props to come up, my negative thoughts to come and join us. Thank you so much. Brilliant. So here we go. So why don't we spread you guys out? Go 1-1-1. So let's say I wasn't invited to a birthday party, all right? And thoughts are coming. You're going, you know what? I mustn't really matter to people. Maybe I won't ever have good friends. I do such stupid things. No one really loves me. I don't even know if I love myself. I feel so unloved. But then something in me rises up. I decide I'm going to start to declare the word of God over my life. And all of a sudden I start saying, I am loved with an everlasting covenant. I am who he says I am. I can do what he says I can do. God has loved me. He will never, nothing can separate me from the love of God. And then what happens is that thought of being unloved, I'm now defeating it with the word of God, what he says about me. I'm a child of God. I'm forgiven of all my sins. I've been adopted into God's family. Nothing can separate me from the love of God. But then guess what? Other feelings are going to come. And it's not to say that we deny the feeling. We've got to go, okay, we understand it. This is where it comes from. But this is what God says about it, okay? So let's say I'm feeling really defeated. I've tried so hard and I've failed. These obstacles are just too big for me. I can't do it. I can't move forward. I'm not capable of anything great. I can never be free from my sinful habits. I can't change my life. It's just who I am. I'm just a powerless victim of what happened in my life. I accept defeat. Don't be a macho man. You wanna be tough. Then I start to declare that I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above only and not beneath. I'm victorious in Christ Jesus. I'm an overcomer. I'm more than a conqueror. And suddenly, that thought that I am defeated is broken. Faith starts to rise up in me. It might try and come back again, but what I've got to do is I've got to keep my gloves on. Some of you got to get your gloves back on. You got to get back in that ring, man. I'm telling you. You got to get your gloves back on and declare the word of God. Let me do one more. Just because I enjoy this. You know, at times in your life, maybe you're going to feel forgotten. I feel like no one sees me. I'm always left out. I'm forgotten. I'm unnoticed. I see God coming through for other people, but can God really come through for me? Does he really have this great plan for me as well? I don't feel like I'm good enough. I don't feel like I'm called. I just feel like I'm forgotten. Then faith rises up in me and I say, I am known by God. I am chosen by God to make a difference. I'm God's masterpiece. I'm not forgotten. His plan for me is good and not evil. And you are defeated. And then those labels start to come down over time. Now listen, it's not just in a moment. We want everything done in a microwave. 2 minutes, boom. It's daily declaring what God says about us. Daily declaring it. And that's what the counselor said as well. He said, you know what? It's more powerful if we get people to declare it, not just think it. It creates stronger pathways in your brain when you declare it over your life, when you declare it. Amazing. And now I realize that, you know what? I'm not unloved. I'm loved by God. I'm not forgotten. I'm chosen by God. And I'm not defeated. I'm not powerless. I'm not a victim. I'm victorious in Jesus' name. Can we give these guys a big hand? Church, would you declare the word of God over your life? Would you get your gloves on? It says they'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. So it's the truth you know. Do you know the truth? Do you know what God says about you? We've got to get into this word. We've got to pick it up and see. We've got a whole bunch of, you know, I've got a whole bunch of declarations and things that I declare. This is what God says about me. This is what he says. It's powerful when we do this. You know, you can, if you write who I am in Christ, there's a whole bunch of scriptures that come up that you can start to declare in your prayer life. And I've been doing it for years and years and years. And that's, it's helped me have a confidence to know who I am in God. It's not necessarily a self-confidence or a all about me, but it's a confidence in God, in His love, and His ability and what He can do through us. So next week at church, we've got a great tag team preach, and each one of the people preaching is going to talk about these three concepts, about what it means to be loved by God, about what it means to be victorious, and to know that we are chosen by God. And that's going to be a phenomenal, phenomenal Sunday happening next week. But why don't we just bow our heads and close our eyes, and I just want to give an opportunity here for people to receive Jesus. If you're here today and you've been away from God, but today you want to make a decision to follow Jesus, to give Him your life, I want to encourage you, friend, that you're not forgotten by God. You're chosen. You're not defeated. You're victorious. And you're not unloved. He loves you so much, just as you are, no matter what you've done. Maybe you'd say, oh, I need to get my life cleaned up before coming to God. Well, that's like saying, I'm too dirty to have a shower. We just go to the shower and we get clean. We can come to Jesus and He'll make us clean. He'll help us to live a holy and honorable life before God. And so if you're here and you want to make that decision, why don't you pop up your hand and say, yes, I want to give my life to Jesus. On the count of three, you can raise your hand. One, two, three. If you say, yes, I want to give my life to Jesus. Awesome, awesome, awesome. I see those hands. So good. Fantastic. Is there anybody else here today that would say, yes, I want to live for Jesus? You can just pop up your hand. Thank you. You can put your hand down. Thank you. I see that hand. That's awesome. If there's anyone else here today, you can just pop up your hand and give me a wave. And we're about to pray in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Well, let's just quickly pray this prayer. Not quickly in a rush. Let's pray this together. And that'd be awesome. Repeat this after me. Say this. Dear Jesus, I give you my life. Thank you that you gave your life for me. I receive you today and I choose to follow you for the rest of my life. Forgive me of all my sins and all my mistakes. I love you, Jesus. And as I say this prayer, I become your precious child. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Why don't we give God some praise this morning?
Wasn't that a great word? Would love to see in the comments what you got out of the word. If you made a decision today, I want to say first of all, congratulations. This is the best decision you will ever make. And here at City Point, we believe that making the decision is the first step in a lifetime journey with God. Which is why I would love you to text decision to the number on the screen or click the link in the chat so we can get alongside you and help you on your journey. And we have three next steps that will help you out on your journey. Number one, keep coming to church. If you're in Auckland, we'd love to have you join us in person at our Sunday 10 a.m. services. But if you're not, we'd love you to keep coming along to our online services at 7:30 p.m. on Sunday. Number two, get connected. Here at City Point, we believe that you should not walk this journey alone, so join a life group. Life groups are where you can connect with other Christians and get to know each other, connect, and draw closer to God and just live life together. We have many life groups going on across Auckland, but if you're not from Auckland, we also have online life groups and would love to have you join. Number three, sign up for Growth Track. Growth Track is a three-step process where you get to draw closer to God, learn more about yourself, and hear the heart and the vision of our church. Once again, if you made a decision today, we are so glad for you and would love to help you out on your next step. Now here at City Point, we believe that generosity is in the believer's lifestyle. And there are two ways you can give. Either you can text City Point to 818 or click the link in the chat. If you are new to City Point or you've been here a while and would like to connect with us, please text the number on the screen or click the link in the chat, as we would love to get in contact with you throughout the week and really just get to know each other and you can hear more about the heart of our church. Thank you for being here today. We're so glad you've joined us and would love to see you next week Sunday, either at 10 a.m. in person or right here at 7:30 p.m. online.